Hello and welcome to Listen In, a music sharing podcast featuring lesser known songs by underrated artists. I'm Jesse, the great musician, and you... No, f***.
This isn't the explicit episode, Jesse.
It is now. Hello and welcome to Listen In, a music sharing podcast featuring lesser known songs by underrated artists. I'm Jesse, the great magician, and you, listener, own a pair of blue jeans.
What? I'm Kay.
And I'm Alexis, and I promise I'll stop saying pretty cool to everything.
No, you're never going to.
Probably not.
So what pretty cool music have you been listening to, Alexis?
This week, there's been a lot of really interesting albums that I wanted to check out that just came out. Obin Jair just released a new album. Kendrick just released a new album. And Florence and the Machine also released a new album. Ooh. And I really want to check it out. But me being a weirdo, I'm, you know, setting my new music consumption to happen on Monday, this upcoming Monday. So I haven't got to listen to the new Florence, so I've just been going back to her like back catalog, mostly listening to her debut and the album High as Hope. So I've been listening to a lot of those two from her.
Awesome.
Pretty cool.
How about you, Kate?
I have been back on YouTube finding things to put on in the background while I am working. And one thing I found that's new, it's not lo-fi or video game music, is Begin Again performances. Begin Again is a Korean TV show. I don't know if it's anywhere else in the world, like it sometimes is, where the original idea is they go busking in other cities across the world where people aren't familiar with the artists who are busking. So they take like well-known Korean artists and they go out into, I don't know, Italy or something, and they sing songs and they do covers. It's super cool. And they film it all and put it on TV and YouTube. This year, because of COVID, they've been doing it in Korea and calling it Begin Again Open Mic. And it's a nice thing to listen to when you like don't have energy or mental space to focus on something.
I have been listening to a new album that just dropped from Kehlani called Blue Water Road. Structurally and melodically, it's kind of a typical contemporary R&B album, but I think just much higher quality than most of the stuff that's out there. And she does take some risks instrumentally, like she has one kind of 80s rock vibe song. Also, I found it interesting, there's one track that really reminded me of Doja Cat's style. And I feel like in the last 5 to 7 years, contemporary R&B has been a little stagnant. And like to hear another artist like Kehlani do something that sounds like a Doja Cat song, it's like, oh, maybe she was an innovator, even though there's all this other baggage that goes on with it. But anyways,
music time.
Let's share some songs. Kay, what you got?
Yeah, so we haven't shared yet that we are doing a theme this week. Our theme is songs from your childhood, which I've chosen to take as like legit childhood, like nothing from teenage years. I wanted young, but I joke that I grew up on Weird Al, Mariah Carey, and musicals, so I was a little stumped on what I should bring until I remembered an album that I listened to as a child that was topically probably questionable for that age, but the sound of which, in hindsight, is probably something that has really influenced my music taste even to today. And that 1997 album is Zoot Suit Riot by the Cherry Poppin' Daddies. On the surface, this is an interesting band name for someone who was 6 when the album released and at most 9-ish when I started listening to them. I don't really remember an exact year, but I don't think it was any older than that. The band seems aware of the unfortunate implications of their name, as their website now just refers to them as The Daddies. Also a hilarious name, honestly. But the original name was chosen during punk counterculture in the 80s and is actually a reference to jive slang that the band members have heard on a vintage race record. It's not intended to be taken literally, as many people have taken it when they hear the name Cherry Poppin' Daddies. To give a full history of the Daddies would take the entire episode, so we'll skip it and talk a bit about the music instead. Frontman Steve Perry talked about wanting to form a punk band and saw punk as, quote, doing whatever the hell you wanted. The band added a horn section and started mixing genres into their sound, like funk and soul, and then later swing and jazz, while keeping some punk influence and social aware lyrics. In 1989, Cherry Pop and Daddies was born, but they didn't find any mainstream momentum until 1997 with Zoot Suit Riot, a compilation album of the swing hits from the band's first three albums, plus four new songs, including the main single Zoot Suit Riot. This finally got them a major label and even a moment in the charts. I listened to the entire album so much that after not hearing it for at least 15 years, I found myself still knowing most of the words, except the ones I didn't understand as a kid. I've chosen to bring a song called Mr. White Keys, which describes a rich, privileged, phony businessman. The nickname White Keys is referring to how bland he is. He only uses the white keys on the piano. In contrast, the song uses a lot of the keys on the piano. You'll hear what I mean. Let's go listen. Enjoy.
Selling cars, not beyond a little sleaze. He's Mr. White Keys. Wife, he loves the tan and blue. Just a little altar truth made America's a zoo. If he can do it, so can you. Sheltered in tax brackets, higher than an angel's clown. Pontificates on rackets and cheats on his wife with his pals. Once he met a musician, shook his hand like a soul man, not a lot like you or me. He's Mr. White Keys. He climbs into daddy's bends and goes collecting the rents of those welfare cheats. A lot of trouble when he tries to find the beat. He dances like a shovel with a couple left feet. He's said he'd rather own the whole damn town than be graceful or be well endowed. Wow. He exaggerates a bit. Foot and mouth, a perfect fit. He's the one who tried the cheese. He's Mr. White Keys. But that don't excuse the prick. He's Mr. White Keys. He's Mr. White Keys. He's Mr. White Keys. Hey! He's Mr. White Keys. He's Mr. White Keys. He's Mr. White Keys. Hey! He's Mr. White Keys. He's Mr. White Keys. Hey, Mr. White Keys. Hey! He climbs into daddy's bands and goes collecting the rents of those welfare cheats.
So when you imagined little, like, 8 or 9 year old Kay, is that what you imagined she'd listen to?
No, not at all.
That's actually a really great question. And well, first off, like, I think the sound is a lot of fun, and I really enjoyed the song itself. It feels really, really whimsical and easygoing in a way.
For me, trying to extrapolate from this song to current K that I'm aware of, I kind of can see the musical complexity and the level of musicianship in this band as something that might have influenced you. Do you feel like that's accurate?
I think that's where I was going to ultimately go. Yeah, that like the chromaticism, that bass, the horns, the super crunchy chords, the general weirdness of honestly, this song in particular is just like a dissonant mess in the best way. So I wanted to just blame or credit, depending on who you talk to, this particular song for my complete immunity to dissonance as an adult. But yeah, I think that that's where that is where that intersects. Like, I love a good crunchy chord in pretty much anything. I love a horn section. I love some like wild and out piano. It's all there. It's just like it's all now broken up into different genres. Mm.
How do you feel about Real Big Fish?
I listen to them a ton.
Okay.
Like, Real Big Fish was one of my first concerts that I chose to go to.
Nice. Very nice.
Yeah, this actually goes in line with the next question that I wanted to ask. Did this springboard you to other things similar to it as you were getting older?
A lot of my music when I was a kid came from, honestly, from like stuff my brother would show me. Shout out to Mike for that. But I think he showed me Real Big Fish and I had gotten really into that. And actually, interestingly, I read somewhere that Real Big Fish is the reason that Cherry Pop and Daddies got a record label.
Oh.
Because Cherry Pop and Daddies, the rest of their stuff is much more ska punk than it is swing.
Mm-hmm.
But there was some story, I think they had maybe toured with Real Big Fish, and they were the ones that set up a meeting with their record label to get Cherry Pop and Daddies on a label. Yeah. That's anyway, what did you think of the song? It's enough about me, really.
I thought it was pretty cool.
Pretty cool.
I mean, all the things we've already kind of mentioned, like the chromaticism, the dissonance, the like sudden breakdowns. I thought the lyrics were fun and interesting. It also was interesting to me that even though the lyrics are fairly unique, I thought that the vocalist wasn't that prominent in the mix. To me, it really sounded like, from the production standpoint, that the instrumentals were the main attraction for the song.
Mm-hmm. I definitely see that.
Mm-hmm. I like the instrumental break the most of the song. This is a short song. It's like 3 minutes, three minutes and like 11 seconds. So it's a pretty short song. It goes by pretty fast. And that instrumental break is really fun because it's like really rhythmic. It's got the snapping going, you know. That instrumental break just feels like a mood. Getting that instrumental break kind of like made the song feel less of a character piece entirely and more of kind of like this world where Mr. White Keys exists.
Did you happen to listen to the piano in the instrumental break?
Is there something in particular?
It gets really weird. Like, it goes full new music, almost 12-tone-esque.
Oh, no, I didn't.
So it's super strange. It is certainly not all White Keys.
Mm-hmm. Kind of interesting that you say, like, this is a character piece because, yes, they're talking about a character as, like, the main subject, but, like, I feel like there is a certain amount of tongue-in-cheek embracing the cheese, like being a character as well. Most people have heard them in their Zoot Suit Riot, and I think it's completely convincing that they are a big band jazz act.
And what a lot of people say when they talk about Zoot Suit Riot, as I was researching for this episode, is that a lot of people know Zoot Suit Riot. They have no idea who performed or sang that song.
Yeah, that's accurate. One line that I particularly enjoyed was foot and mouth, a perfect fit. Like, it just seemed very clever. Like, there's a lot of cleverness in the lyrics as well.
The whole Zoot Suit thing, it's not ringing any bells to me right now.
I would like to challenge you not knowing Zoot Suit Riot. Just real quick, it's like, Zoot Suit Riot, throw back a bottle of beer, Zoot Suit Riot, riot! I kind of want you to record that.
Zoot Suit Riot, the K cut.
Yeah, super fun song. Thanks for bringing it in.
And it's a super fun album, honestly. I haven't really listened to the rest of their music at all. It was just this album. But the entire Zoot Suit Riot album is like swing, ska, punk, bop after bop after bop. I do want to give a listening warning for anybody that goes to listen to it, that the lyrics of track 11 on the album, a song called Drunk Daddy, are very transparently about an abusive alcoholic stepfather. And despite the incredible horn lines in this song, it may be a tough listen for some. Skip if you think it's not for you. Otherwise, give that whole album a listen. It's super fun and also really interesting what topics they go to tackle with this boppy swing sound. What's up next?
All right. Okay, let's take a trip back to a long distant time ago. The time is the year 2007. Tom from MySpace is chilling on your top eight. The smell of pizza rolls is in the air. The most popular movie at the theater is the one of that young wizard at a restaurant with a very indecisive phoenix. And this was the age where it was not uncommon to make music discoveries from watching cable television. What a different time that was. Kenna is an artist that made their debut during this age. And in the fateful year of 2007 was when I discovered him as his sophomore album was being promoted during the commercial breaks on MTV. Kenna is an American pop artist. He was born in Ethiopia and lived there for the first 3 years of his life. After his parents fled the country, Kenna soon followed thereafter, reuniting with them in the United States, where he was eventually raised in Virginia Beach, Virginia. And it was here where he met current longtime friends and future career collaborators Chad Hugo and Pharrell Williams, more commonly known as the Neptunes. Much like pizza rolls, which come in a variety of flavors, Kenna's music is an eclectic mix of many sounds and styles, and that definitely drew me into Kenna's album at the time. Kenna has admitted to loving working with the Neptunes, not just because they were his close friends, but that they treated him without bias, always guiding him without BS or nonsense. Unfortunately, the song I selected from the album is a song that doesn't let Kenna and the Neptunes' imagination shine, as this is more of a low-key song on the album. I decided to go with this song as it's probably the song that has stuck with me the most throughout the years and was definitely the song from that album that I could not stop coming back to during those years of my life. So while it may not be quite an explosive track, it is instead a very special one for me. Without further ado, let's publish that bulletin post with the 50-question survey and gather around a plate full of pizza rolls as we take a listen to the song Be Still by Kenna. Enjoy.
Turn hard, a red
All right. I have to say, I'm really happy right now. Something about that just feels so simple, like so simple and easy. And I think maybe because it's my past with it, but it made me really happy to go back to this and listen to it. I feel like the emotions I'm feeling right now is like I can just like just enjoy the sensation of just like breathing and smelling pizza rolls. I don't know, but I feel really good right now. I feel really happy. How are y'all feeling?
I'm not smelling pizza rolls.
Oh, okay.
But I'm worried if you are and there aren't any. I think that's signs of a stroke.
Well, as long as it's not burnt toast.
We were talking about how the song I brought works into my current day listening, and this just makes total sense to me that what? This is...
Yes, 100%.
It makes total sense to me.
What? Really? Okay, go ahead.
It's 130%. I feel like you could bring that on any week and be like, here's this song I really love, and I wouldn't question it at all. A lot of the things that you've shared on the podcast are sort of this... We've talked a lot about them feeling sort of meditative, and I got the same feeling here with the repetitive, like, bleepy production line that went on and then changed, which was really nice, actually. I like that little break. I really enjoyed it. I really enjoy the songs you bring to the podcast, so thank you.
This is another song that has a looping, like, gradual build where it just, like, stacks more intensity as the song slowly, like, progresses and... Yeah, that meditative quality, that's reflected both in the lyrics and also in the instrumentals and the way the song is portrayed. Speaking to the lyrics, I felt like it was instructive in addition to like having its own internal narrative about like this guy talking to his love.
You can see it as his own personal catharsis, but at the same time feeling as it's like being talked to you as well.
Yes.
And I think the soundscape that was built in this song really mirrors all of that. It's not simple. I see how it feels simple, especially with the repetitive lyrics. And there are only a few main elements, but each element individually is already very complicated. And then when you layer them, even though they're looping, it's like a pretty complex rhythm you're getting in this song. It feels like you're working through something hard. And I think that that mirrors the lyrics of Don't Run From Healing just really well. It's a cool effect.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is a bit of like an edge or like an underlying tension that especially the rhythm and the drums bring.
Yeah, I feel like there is definitely complexity here and tension. Back in like 2007 to like maybe 2012, I definitely came to it to appreciate it for a more thoughtful thing, and especially in its place in my life emotionally. I did feel like I kind of gravitated to it to kind of like soothe me in certain emotional experiences of my life.
It feels affirming in a way. You know when you're having a really bad day and like somebody's like, oh man, that sucks so much. Mm-hmm. Like, but just something about somebody being like, yeah, like you deserve to feel that way feels kind of comforting in its own way. That's how this song feels to me. It feels like if you're having like a lot of emotions and a little bit of angst and a little bit of moment of complexity or not sure where to turn, it feels like this song is affirming those feelings while also telling you like it's gonna be okay, you're gonna heal, don't run.
Yeah, I get the same feeling. It's powerful.
Very. I also want to commend them for using the word taciturn and reticent.
It's such a good word.
And I wanted to note that Mr. Whitekeys has pontificate. So I will be expecting some bizarre SAT word in your song, Jesse.
Okay, no promises.
If you enjoyed this song, or kind of like the era that it belongs to, I would say it's probably worth checking out because it is a bit of a time capsule, I would say. That's the best way to describe it. There's songs that sound like straight up Radiohead, things that sound like Justin Timberlake. So like it's very fresh. Kenna, as far as I know, isn't really active right now. He was kind of like pushing to get a third album out and kind of stopped right before it came out. I don't really know what happened with that. But yeah, I couldn't find anything in terms of like what he's doing right now. Thank you for listening.
good stuff. All right, the band I'm bringing you is Polaris, which was the house band for the early 90s live-action Nickelodeon TV show, The Adventures of Pete and Pete. It was formed from most of the members of the band Miracle Legion, with a different guitarist and some other guest contributors. They wrote and recorded the intro music, as well as a large album's worth of songs for the general show soundtrack, and even appeared in one of the episodes as a band playing in a garage. The showrunners were big fans of Miracle Legion, but there were some contract disputes with their label that necessitated forming Polaris for the TV project. To give some context, the show first came out when I was at the impressionable age of 4 or 5, still forming ideas about how the world worked, and it was maybe my first introduction to the genre of magical realism, which might explain some things. The show focused around the strange suburban life of two brothers, both named Pete. I remember episodes about their mom having a metal plate in her head and it interacting with radio waves, little Pete pranking their school with drums of potentially radioactive creamed corn, and my favorite recurring character, the neighborhood superhero Artie, who was a very average-looking man who dressed like Where's Waldo without the hat, but claimed he was the strongest man in the world. I spent many fun Saturday mornings glued to the TV, being immersed in their just slightly bizarre reality, with no cares in the world, no responsibilities that I had to do, just a good time. And to me, the theme song I'm sharing with you, Hey Sandy, perfectly captures the whimsical weirdness of that show. And every time I listen to it, I get nostalgic, warm, fuzzy feelings. Let's give it a listen. Hey Sandy by Polaris.
Jupiter or Thor is perfect. We need Atlas for our long distance stuff. The Titan will be even better. They shouldn't have canceled Navajo. Wait till you see our submarines with Polaris.
Attention all personnel, this is CVTS. Space vehicle pre-count operations will start on my mark at 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
All right. How was your lack of pizza rolls now?
I, again, did not feel surprised by this choice somehow. And yes, my dog does bite.
Are you Sandy? Oh my gosh. Mystery solved. How are you not surprised is my follow-up question, I suppose.
Oh, I was waiting for Alexis to say something.
I'm currently being attacked by Kay's dog, so I'm incapacitated. I can't even speak words.
Okay. Anyway, I am not surprised. I don't know why I'm not surprised, actually. It just kind of made sense. It just felt right. It just seemed like you. I do also want to give you credit. It does use the word deranged, which for a song with very few words, we'll give it the big word credit on deranged.
Generous of you, I think.
It's kind of like, it's a weird word to fit into a song. It's a tough one.
So I knew nothing about Pete and Pete before this, surprisingly. And this feels so much of the time. Very, very 90s. And the music is so nostalgic. This was a blast to listen to, actually, and seeing like how the creators really like this band and tried their best to like make sure that they're the ones that are providing the music because they have a sound that they want to achieve. I thought that's such a cool thing, because I think that even though I have never seen Pete and Pete before, I can kind of already tell like this is something that I could gravitate to. You probably just get so much feeling of nostalgia for that time, for this show that seems significant to you. So yeah, it's just like it provides so much to you, and I think that's, it sounds like it does, and I think that's pretty cool.
Yeah,
pretty cool.
What do you like most about this song, Jesse? Why, out of all of the songs you listened to in childhood, this was the one you brought?
I would say maybe my favorite part is the like highly reverbed surf guitar solo. Also, like, the fact that you can't really understand the lyrics.
Like, except, "Hey Sandy, does your dog bite?" I got that the first listen.
I for the longest time, thought "Hey Sandy" was "It's in me" as a lyric.
Wow, that's not good.
No. More of, like, an emotion is in me, not, like, a physical thing is in me.
I see.
He could have been talking about, like, a splinter or pizza rolls or...
Dog teeth.
Yeah, like it's very bare composition wise. It's very rough. Apparently the recording of it was done very quickly, with not a lot of room for polish. But I think it totally fits for like being a weird alternate reality, magical realism sort of vibe. Which is not about the song. Sorry. Mm-hmm. Like, it's hard for me to talk about the song, but like I like the punk-ish rhythm of it. I know Kay is less of a fan of 90s music, but I like a lot of 90s music. And this kind of fits in that mold as well.
I didn't mind it. It was sort of that like more of the late 90s alt rockish sound, but like a garage band made up of teenagers. Is that accurate? I'm not good at genre.
That feels right. Although the show came out in 1993.
I will say that I'm going to spend the rest of my day walking around going, "Hey, Sandy, what does your dog bite?" I'm just going to ask everybody I see that. "What does your dog bite?" And see what they say. Nobody's going to get it. Thanks, Jesse.
You're welcome. I feel like I contributed to your life today. Enriching your lived experience.
It was a really fun song that we was certainly fun in.
Mm-hmm. We was fun in.
I enjoyed it for that. I really liked the opening too. I don't know what Jupiter or Thor is perfect means, but
I had to look that up. Jupiter, Thor, Titan, and Navajo are names of Cold War era intercontinental ballistic missiles. For a kids show.
Yeah. Oh, a happy.
Natural. Yeah. Naturally.
I really like that kind of old 50s vibe.
I think TV shows definitely have really great music that is like, you know, just music for the TV show itself, like theme songs and things like that. And this was a introduction to a show that I've never heard about, surprisingly. I don't know how. And hearing you describe it as magical realism, that really catches my eye, because with this whole magical realism, it sounds like it probably makes ordinary life, it probably like portrays it in a slightly more sublime way. So it makes me really interested to probably check it out. This was a really, really cool choice.
So Polaris has, as they're not like a real band, they're actually Miracle Legion, but with some shifted parts. That's and so Miracle Legion is like the main thing that they do. Polaris had a reunion live performance in 2017, and they did release a single after that called Great Big Happy Green Moon Face. I guess if you like this, then maybe checking out Miracle Legion might be the next step. But besides that, yeah, gotta try to wrap up another show. Not knowing how.
Doing a really great job of it, Jesse. Keep going.
All right, keeping going. Yeah, leave us a comment. Let us know what you like, what you don't like. Boop that subscribe button. Hit the bell. Or is it a gong? I don't know. Hit the thing. Hit it. Yeah.
I fully expect you to say boop as you do it, or I'm disappointed and it doesn't count.
You're looking happily deranged there. Can you settle to boop me?
Yes.
I think you should consider that as a new pickup line.
This probably leaks better than everything else I've ever thought of.
Hey there, baby. Can you settle to boop me?
Oh, oh no. With that tone of voice, I feel a little bit differently now.
No. Put that away.
Is that the thing that influenced you, I wonder? Okay.
You might have lost her.
Oh, no.
Uh-oh.
Ruh-roh.
Okay, we are experiencing technical difficulties.
Okay, I'll fill in for her. Yes, I am Kay. I do Kay things. I like music. I am very smart. KKK. I am Kay.
I wonder if she's going to like find that in the recording.
I hope so.
What am I gonna find? I'll find it in the recording.